actually implementing a program. But let's just see now what it is we've been doing all this time and what some of the final.
So we can sort of take one final peek at some abstraction here when we talk about compiling.
Yeah, this is a topic I've always wrestled with as to how low level to get and when to do it. Like, we've oscillated over the years as to where this topic, if anywhere, goes. And in recent years, I've really just kind of thrown it into the middle of the class when there's, like, a gap. And it never felt right there. And this was the first year where we've really done it this early, talking about pre-processing, compiling, assembling, and linking. And I actually think it kind of worked. I mean, we allowed ourselves the luxury this year of having variable-length lectures.
Right.
So we gave ourselves more time if we wanted it and less time if we didn't need it. I didn't want to scare too much, right, because we're only in the second week, really, of the class here. But I think it helps, so long as we don't dwell too much on it. I think it helps to kind of go all the way down to where assembly meets, or really where machine code meets source code, and then just abstract on top of that.
Yeah, we don't really get into this sort of detail again later in the course, but like you said, knowing when pound include happens, when pound define happens, and how exactly the CS50's library when you do pound include it, how those bytes get integrated into your program. Like, it's something that's worth talking about early, but like you said, like we want to abstract away from that. We don't want to make that the takeaway here. Just this additional piece of understanding about what's going on.
And I actually feel now, in retrospect, it's now or never, because it was always weird to do it mid-semester and sort of blow up the abstraction and go back down and look at what's really been going on, and there's just no contextual motivation for it. Whereas here, at least, I think just minutes after students have started seeing clang and make and seeing fairly cryptic commands or command line arguments appear on the screen, like giving them a sense of like what those things are doing so that it's not so cryptic.
Yeah, the first
anymore.
Time that they compile a program, now they're actually doing it.
Yeah.
I will say the one tricky thing about explaining this is that compiling contains a step called compiling.
Yeah, I know, it's not obvious. So hopefully having that list of just the four steps that most people just call compiling altogether helps. And this is the only time we show assembly. And we don't really go into detail as to the registers and the instructions as to what's going on here, but I think it's kind of neat to give students a glimpse of that. It's not zeros and ones, but it's also not C.
That's true. And in CS50 AP, we actually do have a problem where we do have students take a look at assembly. When I took CS50, we had a problem set that was written in assembly. It certainly it makes you long for the days of C if you're
Yes, you very quickly appreciate. But that's not the goal here.
No.
But you can start to pluck out familiar things, right? Like the low-level printf instruction and the notion of returning or pushing and popping will actually come
moving,
back to
moving, adding,
later
on. Calling. Yeah, you see some things in there. It's clearly one step lower than the C-like syntax we're used to, but we're not quite down to zeros and ones yet.
But what I like too is the notion of linking, especially, right? Especially doing the hash include at the top of your file really is just giving you access to the header file, but not the underlying zeros and ones into which the library itself has been compiled. So making this distinction between header file and the actual library code, the formerly .c file that's a .so or .o or whatever somewhere on the file system, where those bits are coming from that compose printf, I think is pretty helpful to mention.
Yeah, it's not the kind of thing that needs to remain a mystery, because if people want to go on and do and use the CS50 library in an environment that's not the CS50 IDE, it's helpful to know exactly how to recreate that and where to store it in your file system even. Again, these small little skills that are nice to know but are not essential to taking CS50.
So it's the complete story, and especially by way of things being on video, if a student really doesn't want to dive into this just yet, or maybe it's a little too much too soon, skip over, come back, but at least it's chronologically now, I think, in the right place.
Yeah, I agree.